Welcome to my classroom. In this Master Answer 1 course, module number 4, humidification. In this lecture number 41, we will discuss about procedure to be followed in determining the height of the packed bed for cooling tower operations, and we will practice few numericals also. Please be ready with calculator, graph sheets, psychrometric charts, so that we can solve the numericals. Ready? So in the previous lecture, we have derived an expression for height of the packed tower in terms of individual mass transfer coefficient in gas phase, right? So we got height of the packed tower equal to gs dash kya into integral dh dash by hi dash minus h dash, where this hi is the enthalpy at the gas liquid interface, yi dash is the humidity, okay, absolute humidity, a is the interfacial area per unit length of the bed, okay. And I told you to practice derivation for same derivation can be done in terms of overall mass transfer coefficient. So in that case, instead of hi, we will be having the h star, okay, where h star is the enthalpy of saturated air at a temperature equal to bulk liquid temperature. Okay, in our derivation equation number 17, we wrote individual gas phase mass transfer coefficient. So the same can be written in terms of overall mass transfer coefficient, where h star dash is the enthalpy of the air in equilibrium with the bulk air. So this also you can say it as enthalpy of saturated air at temperature TL. So how to relate this overall mass transfer coefficient to individual mass transfer coefficient? You can refer to textbook. So by adding and subtracting by hi dash, we can bring the relationship between overall mass transfer coefficient and individual mass transfer coefficients, which can have in this form. Okay. So we can write the height of the packed tower in terms of this overall mass transfer coefficient. Okay. So if you derive the expression, finally we are going to get z as a function of height of transfer units and the number of transfer units, where number of transfer units will be the number of transfer units will be area under the curve on the plot of h dash versus 1 by h star minus h dash, okay, where h star is the saturated enthalpy. Okay, so the number of transfer units can be determined by drawing a plot of h dash versus 1 by h star minus h dash. So what will be the difference is, if you are solving the numerical either in terms of gas fill mass transfer coefficient small ky or in terms of overall mass transfer coefficient capital ky, in the difference is the points that we are drawing, no, in between temperature TL1 and TL2, we will be marking the slope lines. Okay, so that slope will be different. Say for example, if it is when we use overall mass transfer coefficient, the slopes are vertical, okay, whereas here the slopes will be having a value based on the parameters. So that will be the major difference between solving the numericals in for gas film mass transfer coefficient and overall mass transfer coefficient. Please note, in gas film mass transfer coefficient we make use of interface enthalpy hi, whereas in case of overall mass transfer coefficient we use saturation enthalpy h star. Okay, so we use dh star by dtl. Here it will be dhi by dtl. Please refer to the derivations for gas fill mass transfer coefficient as well as overall mass transfer coefficient. Here we define two terms called approach and range. So range is the difference in hot water temperature and cold water temperature is called as range, and the difference in wet bulb temperature of the air inlet and the cold water, that is the water outlet, that is called as approach. So these two terms will be used, we will define it later also. Okay, so principally the difference between gas fill mass transfer coefficient and overall mass transfer coefficient height of the packed tower is that the slopes will be, here we will have a slope with a certain value, whereas for overall mass transfer coefficient we have to just line a vertical lines. Okay,
So what will be the slope? So the slopes will be equal to minus HLA by KYA into molecular weight of B, air. Okay, so if A is equal, then HL by KY MB is the slope for these lines which connecting this operating line and the equilibrium line. Okay, so we have the assumptions we have already seen. There are four assumptions made. After that, these two we should know, that adiabatic cooling or evaporative cool, adiabatic cooling of water is taking place in the tower. The rate of evaporation is very less than the rate of the water input. So we have defined what is psychrometric ratio. Hg by Ky is called psychrometric ratio, and this Tg minus Tw is equal to lambda into Hs minus H by Hg by Ky. Okay, so where lambda is the latent heat of evaporation of water, Hs is the saturation humidity. Okay, here enthalpy we are using H, so we will be using Ys. This Ys dash is saturation humidity, Y dash is absolute humidity. Okay, so we can rewrite the formula accordingly in terms of Y. Okay, we will solve few numericals. Before that, just recall what are the, for the design of a cooling tower, so the following values will be needed. Okay, so cooling range, wet bulb temperature, what is approach to wet bulb temperature, what is mass flow rate of the water, that is circulation rate, air velocity through the tower or individual tower cell, tower height. Okay, the performance of the cooling tower is estimated by approach and range. I told you what is approach and what is range. Range is the difference in the liquid temperature, whereas approach is the difference, bottom condition difference. What is that? Gas temperature and the liquid temperature. The difference is called approach. Range is liquid temperature, inlet minus outlet. That will give us the range. Okay, so the, during the performance assessment, portable monitoring instruments are used to measure the following parameters like dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature, cooling tower inlet water temperature, cooling tower outlet water temperature, and electrical readings to know what is the pump flow rate, all that. Okay, and exhaust air temperature, water flow rates, air flow rates. Okay, we have seen how to do material balance for any unit operation. We have done CPC course, so we know how to write the material balance. So if you consider what is the water makeup, total water losses, drift losses plus evaporation losses plus blowdown losses, so the total water loss will be compensated by fresh water makeup. Okay, because whatever is recirculated, same amount will be there in the system. So whatever is the loss, there may be three losses: drift losses, evaporation losses plus blowdown losses. So this amount of water will be again freshly supplied to makeup. Okay, that's why it's called makeup water. Okay, and evaporation too, we have formulas to calculate the evaporation losses. You can refer to Perry Chemical Engineering Handbook. So we have formula for evaporation loss, blowdown or draw of loss, and we can define what is cycle of concentration, because sometimes water may be treated, water, some chemicals needs to be added. We have some formula which we can make use. Simply range by range plus approach into 100 gives us the cooling tower efficiency, or to be more specific, cooling to, what is range? Range is the cold water. What is cold water? That is hot water minus cold water. That is inlet water minus outlet water temperature is range. And range plus approach can be obtained by cooling tower inlet water temperature minus wet bulb temperature. So that way, in general, we are going to have a cooling tower efficiency between 65% to 70%. Okay. Okay, first let us solve this problem, a simple one. An air water vapor, an air water vapor mixture at 1 atmosphere has dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature of 64.5 degrees Celsius and 31.1 degrees Celsius. If the latent heat of vaporization of water is 579.4 kilocalorie per kg, calculate the psychrometric ratio. Okay, so psychrometric ratio is Hg by Ky. So how to get that, this one? So from the psychrometric chart, first we will mark the wet bulb temperature in this 100% saturation line. and dry bulb temperature is known. So you have dry bulb temperature. So from wet bulb temperature, first you will mark the wet bulb temperature here. Values will be given in the chart. So from there you will mark the dry bulb temperature. So the corresponding value you will get as absolute humidity H value we can get. And similarly for this temperature, dry bulb temperature, what will be the 100% saturation humidity? So adiabatic saturation, this one. So in the 100% line, whatever is the corresponding value, that is our HS value, that is saturation humidity value. Okay. Now just substitute in the formula and encircle the right, you will get one of them as the answer. Okay, so it's a simple one, so it's only determination of Hg by Ky value. Okay, so you substituting the values, you will get the answer. Lambda value is known, latent heat of vapor recession is given. So Hs value, H value you will get from the graph, and Tg and Tw values are known, so you can calculate the psychrometric ratio. Okay, first let us see the standard procedure that we have to follow to determine the height of a packed tower. So here we'll discuss that one first. Okay, so among the dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature and humidity of the entering air, so out of these three datas, any two will be given. Okay, so that way we should know, for use of psychrometric chart itself, if any two parameters are known, remaining parameters can be taken from the psychrometric chart. Okay, so among the dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature and absolute humidity of the entering air, two data will be known. So obviously from the psychrometric chart we can find out the third parameter. Say for example, if you know wet bulb temperature and dry bulb temperature of the entering air, because it can be easily measured, right? So whatever is the atmospheric temperature, and if you keep a wet week, we can determine the what is the wet bulb temperature. So those two can be easily determined. So if these two are known using the psychrometric chart, we can find out the absolute humidity of the air entering, air inlet. Okay, so in that, what we can do, how to get that one? So first we will mark the dry bulb temperature line, then we will mark the wet bulb temperature line. So we will mark the point of intersection, so and the corresponding y-axis value is the absolute humidity. Okay, for example, if you know the dry bulb temperature, so if for any temperature, let me say 30 degrees Celsius, and if you know wet bulb temperature, let it be 20 degrees Celsius. Okay, so if it is 20 degrees Celsius, we have here, so dry bulb temperature 30, wet bulb temperature 20, means how we will get the absolute humidity. So if you draw a line along this y-axis, we will get the specific humidity or absolute humidity. Here it is in grams per kg, we can easily convert to kg per kg. Okay, so if you mark the point, then if you draw a line, you are going to get absolute humidity. And from the point P, if you move to the left towards the 100% saturation, remember 60%, 80%, next is 100% saturation line, so the corresponding value is your dew point temperature. So in one of the practice numericals we have done, so by mistake this line was drawn up to here and taken, so you please correct that lecture. Okay, I think even in comment section I have changed that one. I told you, so it's not up to here, it's not 9, it will be getting 19 degrees something. Okay, so that way that problem, you please make the correction in that lecture. So here also, at the 100% saturation line we have to go down, because sometimes if it is not colored in black and white charts and all, I used to simply move this is the 100% line, but here we have to check what is this. This is enthalpy scale, so the curves are ending here, so remember it will be curve, not straight line. So with that we will get the dew point temperature. Okay, so even you can get the specific volume, but for this numerical we may not need that one. Okay, but you can get the enthalpy value from the same chart. So enthalpy value will be, say for example it is 50 60, so from this line parallel to this we can get around, it may be 55, so maybe 57 is the corresponding value, enthalpy value. Okay, So for any graphical method on numerical on cooling towers, among the dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature and humidity, two parameters will be known. From that we can get the third parameter. Okay, so then we can make use of the formulas. See, remember, different books will have different notations. We can adjust it. Okay, only we should know what is what. Okay, so you mentioned CS humid air equal to Cp of air plus Cp of water into Y1 dash. So we can say CS plus Cl into Y1 dash. In derivations, we have defined what is CS and Cl. Okay, so the CS of humid air is Cp of air plus Cp of water into absolute humidity. Okay, so now then we can find out the enthalpy using the formula or from the graph. So enthalpy of the entering air at a temperature of TA, if T naught is the 0 degree Celsius reference temperature, then we can say H1 dash is equal to CS into TA, which is air entering temperature, minus T naught plus. Okay, please note down. First step is, for the graphical method numerical on cooling towers, first thing is, among three parameters between dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature, relative humidity or absolute humidity of the entering air, we should know any two parameters. Okay, for example, if you know wet bulb temperature and dry bulb temperature, we can get the absolute humidity from the psychrometric chart. Okay, so that we can see from the actual chart. Okay, then CS of humid air can be determined using CS plus CL into Y1 dash, where CS is the Cp of air, CL is the Cp of liquid, and Y1 dash is the absolute enthalpy. Okay, then enthalpy of the entering air at a temperature of TA can be determined using the formula. Enthalpy H1 dash is equal to CS into TA minus T naught plus lambda naught into Y1 dash. Okay, so where T naught and lambda naught refers to reference temperature of 0 degree Celsius. Okay, now we have to plot the equilibrium curve. How to plot the equilibrium curve? There are two ways. There may be data directly given. For example, if you know the saturation enthalpy versus temperature, we have to plot only within our operating range. What is our operating range? What is T here? T is the liquid temperature. So inlet liquid temperature and outlet liquid temperatures are known. We can only restrict ourselves to TL1 and TL2, where TL1 is entering water temperature and TL2 is leaving water temperature. So usually entering water will be hot, leaving water will be cool. So you will have TL1 have higher value, TL2 will be lower value. Okay, so directly H star versus T is given. Simple, we can plot an equilibrium curve, which is nothing but 100% saturation, right? So that okay, so that is corresponding to saturation value. That is 100% saturation, because air is saturated with water at equilibrium. That is one of the assumptions, right? So if H star versus temperature is not directly given, what we can do is, using psychrometric chart and the temperature of the entering water, it may be, say for example, in a cooling tower, water may enter at 90 degrees Celsius and leave at 40 degrees Celsius. Well, so after, if you have these three parameters, next step is to plot the saturated enthalpy, saturation enthalpy curve, equilibrium curve versus liquid temperature. And within the liquid temperature range, what is our working range of the liquid? It is liquid inlet temperature and outlet temperature. Remember, in our countercurrent operation, one represents bottom condition, two represents top conditions. In our countercurrent gas liquid operations, we send in the liquid from the top. So TL2 refers to entering water temperature, and liquid will be leaving from the bottom. So TL1 refers to leaving water temperature. So obviously hot water will be entering and cold water will be leaving this cooling tower. So TL2 will be greater than TL1. So between this range, so if directly given H star versus T, we can plot H in the X axis and H star is the saturation enthalpy in the Y axis. We will get a curve like this. Okay, so that is the case one where data is directly given in tabular form. H star versus T will be given. So only we have to plot within our range of TL1 and TL2. Second case, we don't, saturation enthalpy data is not given. What shall we do? We have a psychrometric chart. So we know what is the liquid water entering temperature and leaving temperatures, TL1 and TL2. And in the psychrometric chart, we know which one is the 100% saturation line, right? So we can mark this TL1 and TL2, and we up to saturation line, 100% saturation line, we can mark, and the corresponding enthalpy values in kilojoules per kg can be taken. So we choose only TL1, TL2, random, it's only in a equal interval. You can say TL1 and TL2 are 30 and 60. We can say 35, 40, 45, 50, 60, up to 60. We can note down the temperatures, and for those temperatures between TL1 and TL2 at equal intervals, note down the H1, H star value. This enthalpy value is H star value. How we will get that value? So we'll show you a demo here. Say for example, if this is the psychrometric chart and we have water inlet temperature, let me say 45 degrees Celsius, and we have water outlet, okay, water is entering at high temperature. So it is water entering the tower, it is 45 degrees Celsius, water is leaving the tower at 15 degrees Celsius. Okay, so where do we have this? So 15 degrees Celsius is here, 45 degrees Celsius is here. So we can draw a line, vertical lines. But where is our 100% saturation line? You see here. So we know that this line is 100% saturation line. You can see here it is written 10% relative humidity, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. So this is the outermost line, is the 100% saturation line. Okay. So there only even the wet bulb temperatures are noted. Okay. So now how to mark that one? So I told you 15 degrees Celsius and 45 degrees Celsius. So what you can do? You can mark a line on 15 degrees Celsius and 45 degrees Celsius. Now at the 100, where it is touching the 100% saturation, this is the enthalpy curve, a scale, right? 10, 20, 30, 40, 60, like this. And beyond this, what it is written is, here it is 80, 90, 100. So here it is written 110, 120, and similarly next line will be 130. So accordingly, so we can get the value of enthalpy from the scale of 10, 20, 30. Here it is 100, 110, 120. Next is going to be 130. So in between, so if this much length is 10, so we can find out what is this length corresponding to. Okay, so you will get the enthalpy value. How we will get? We will take equal intervals. Say for example, we can mark various temperatures in between, and the corresponding, how to get the enthalpy value? Is it the 15 is enthalpy value? No. This is only wet bulb temperature at this one. So that also not corresponding to this. So this scale is wet bulb scale. So where to get enthalpy? Here it is. It is written clearly, enthalpy kilojoule per kilomole of dry air. So varying from 10, 20, 30 to 100, 110, 120, 130. So how to get the value? So again, keep a scale parallel to these enthalpy lines and mark up to here to get the corresponding enthalpy value here. Okay, and for this line you'll get the corresponding value here. For next line, again draw this one. So similarly, so you can note down the enthalpy values here. But after this line, what happens? They have brought the scale to this axis, X axis itself, right? So that way it is written clearly 110, 120 here. So the corresponding values you can easily note down for enthalpy corresponding to the temperatures between liquid temperature, inlet and outlet temperatures of the liquid that is entering the cooling tower. So what we'll have? So we'll have an data of, say for example, we have taken a temperature between If you have taken the temperature range between 15 degree and 40 degree Celsius, so you might have taken 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, up to 40 only, right? So we will take data accordingly, and from the graph we will get the corresponding value. Like for 15 it is around 45, 43, 51, 43, 51, like that corresponding values you will write. Okay, so temperature of the liquid, which is H star, so for example 43, 51, etc. kilojoule per kg of dry air can be obtained. Okay, so once we have the data table here, so once we have the table, so correspond, you plot the temperature of the liquid in the x-axis here. Okay, so take appropriate scale. For me, we want the range to be in between 15 to 40. So accordingly, you can take, right? 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. Accordingly, you can plot up to, we don't want to plot up to 100 because our working range is up to 45 only. Okay, 40 only. So you can keep up to 45 here. So accordingly, you can choose the scale wider range also. Okay. And in the y-axis, we will plot the enthalpy H star, saturation enthalpy, which is in kilojoules per kg dry air. It will plot it in the y-axis. Okay, so we will get a plot like this. Okay, so if we plot a graph, so we will get a H star versus temperature of the liquid between TL1. You can see the TL1, TL2 here, H star value. So you will get a equilibrium curve like this. Okay, so this is our H star line, H star versus temperature of the liquid. Okay, so that's what we get. Now what to do next, I'll just explain. So in the equilibrium curve, so once you have plotted this H star versus temperature of the liquid, okay, so you will plot the equilibrium curve. So in this equilibrium curve, so now we know what is the temperature of the liquid leaving the system and H1 value, right? So if these two values are known, so you can mark this point M in this graph somewhere. Temperature of the liquid leaving the system will be less, so here you will mark the TL1 value. Okay, so TL1 and the corresponding H star value, H1 value, right? You can put dash also, no problem. Okay, so we found the absolute humidity value corresponding to it. So you can mark that point M in the graph. Okay, TL1 comma H1 dash, absolute humidity. Okay, so then how to get the gas flow rate, minimum gas flow rate, GS dash value. We have already seen that the minimum gas flow rate will be corresponding to, if you draw a tangent line from M to the equilibrium curve, we can find the slope corresponding to it. So the first draw a tangential line to the equilibrium curve, then determine the slope dy by dx. Okay, so if you find the slope, that slope is equal to ls dash cl by gs dash minimum. So where ls dash is the liquid flow rate, which will be known, cp of water will be known, so slope is known, so only unknown parameter is gs dash minimum. So we can find out the what is gs dash minimum. Okay, once we have the gs dash minimum, so we can determine the actual air flow rate, gs actual. So gs dash actual will be equal to usually 1.25 to 1.5 times the GS dash minimum. So that by we can find out what is GS dash actual. Okay, so if you know the GS dash actual, again we substitute in the slope equation, where slope equal to LS dash CL by GS dash actual. We can substitute the value of GS dash actual. CL is known, LS dash is known, and we can substitute in this equation to find what is H2 value. So once we know this H2 dash value, we can mark again point N, which is TL2 comma H2 dash. So L2 dash we will get from equation. So from simplifying, we will get the only unknown parameter will be H2 dash, because H1 dash is known already. TL2 is known, TL1 is known, LS dash, CL, GS dash, actual we got from here. So only unknown parameter will be H2 dash. So once you get H2 dash, we can mark this point N here. Okay. So once we mark the point N, we can join M and N, and M and will be the operating line. Okay, so that I will explain here. So first what we do, we get the enthalpy data by from the psychrometric chart. If it is not directly given, when H star versus temperature, liquid temperature data is not given directly, we use the psychrometric chart, and between liquid temperatures, inlet liquid temperature and outlet in liquid temperature, we mark equal interval some values, and the corresponding enthalpy values are our H star value. Okay, what is H star? It is enthalpy. H star refers to saturation enthalpy, that is 100% saturation line, right? So corresponding to it, what is our H star dash value, we are determining. Okay, once we are done with that, we are drawing a tangent line. So after plotting point M, TL1 comma H1 dash, so here it is our TL1 comma H1 dash. So we have to draw a tangent line here, because tangent line is what? For any curve, tangent line is, it should just touch the outermost part of the curve. Okay, so it should just to touch the line. Okay, so wherever it may be, okay, it may be curve is like this, from here we cannot draw here curve, it has to touch it here. Okay, so whatever may be the shape of the equilibrium curve, we have to careful to draw a tangential line. Okay, so your tangential line corresponds to here, this is the condition corresponding to, you see, if we consider it to be the operating line, then it is very close to equilibrium. Something is very close to equilibrium, it means that there is lot of resistance to mass transfer. Driving force is very less. So when the driving force is very less, the process is going to be slow, and to affect the mass transfer, we need infinite number of stages. But if we operate, that's why we move away from this tangent line, and we always want to have an actual operating line away from the tangent line. Okay, so that way, away from the it is away from the equilibrium curve means more is the driving force. When there is huge driving force, the rate of mass transfer will be high. Okay. So now, after drawing the tangential line, we draw a slope. You take any two boxes easy, no? So if you consider two boxes, means I can easily know 43 minus 37. That will be two boxes here. Anyone, either dy by dx we have to get. Okay? We have to get the value of dy by dx. So either fix dy or dx, because one data at least easily you can note down, because in exam, you may be running short of time. So either you fix two scales of y-axis or two scales of x-axis and the corresponding value. So this is going to be dy and this is going to be dx. Okay, correspondingly in this scale we have to take down what is the dx value and dy value. So once you get the slope, that slope value can be equated, right? That's what I told. The slope can be equated to LS dash CL. What is CL? CP of water. Okay. So once you get this GS dash value, we substitute to get GS dash actual. So once we get the GS dash actual, okay, so we will get the H2 dash value. So once we get the H2 dash value, we plot it H2 dash and TL2. In the mark the point N, and once we mark the how we will get is, so what we have done, we have an operating line M comma N. Okay, so we have a equilibrium curve, and we have drawn a tangential line to this equilibrium curve. Okay, so from this we get dy by dx value. Okay, so but from that, what we got from dy by dx, we got the H2 dash value, absolute enthalpy of the gas entering. Enthalpy of gas leaving cooling tower. Okay, so once we mark, so when we know H2 dash, we can mark a TL2 comma H2 dash in this curve. So that is our end point. Okay. So TL2 comma H2 dash. What is our M? It is TL1 comma H1 dash. Okay. So once we mark this point N, we can join M and N, and this and this MN is the operating line for cooling tower operation. Okay, so that's what we have here. So for any given problem, we will mark the point M by drawing the tangential line. Say for example, here you can see a tangential line is drawn, and the corresponding dy by dx value can be determined to get what is the value. So once we get this h2 dash, okay, tl2 comma h2 dash, we have the point N. So that point is, and joining this MN, we have the operating line equation. Okay, so that's our operating line equation. So next, what we have to do, finally we will have this graph like this. Okay, so the now in between this TL1 and TL2, we want to take some interval. In equal intervals, we will choose at least 5 temperatures in between TL1, because this is our operating line, this is our M, this is our N, right? So between this TL1 and TL2, at the equal intervals, you have to choose some temperatures. So you take some values, because again we are going to plot this for a given temperature. What is your H dash value? Okay, and then what is the H star value? Okay, so that data we are going to extract for our operating range. Okay, so that's what I'll explain here. So how we will get that? For any temperature we choose, for example, if I draw a line here, value corresponding to operating line is my H dash value. Value, if I extend the same curve up to here, see, remember, if this is to be done for overall mass transfer coefficient case. For overall mass transfer coefficient case, is simply vertical line to enthalpy curve, H star curve, we will get the data. Okay, so the values corresponding to this one will be H dash star. Okay, so that all three we have to note down. Temperature, we only choosing H star value. This is corresponding to MN, and this is corresponding to H star versus temperature, right? So these are H star versus temperature of the liquid. So that way we have to take data, extrapolate from this curve, we have to take the data. Okay, so how we can extract data? For example, in this diagram, we have point M, we have point N, so we have this curve. So TL1 line is there. We can, for example, we can take any 2, 3, 4 data values. So for these temperatures, whatever is the temperature in x-axis, we will note down. So we have temperature. Okay, for the each temperature, what you have to do, you have to get the corresponding value. Say for example, in brown color I am showing equilibrium curve. So this is our equilibrium curve, right? So in the equilibrium curve, what are the corresponding y-axis value for each temperature we have taken? Okay, so first note down the temperature TL1. So lower end is TL1, final is TL2. In between, whatever is the temperature and H star value can be plotted from the graph, so, and H dash value can be plotted. So take, because we are going to make a graph of 1 by H dash star minus H dash. So we will plot H dash versus 1 by H star minus H dash. Okay, so that is the purpose. For that, we are extrapolating data from the graph. So once we mark this thing, so this brown color refers to equilibrium saturated line. So if I mark this, whatever is shown in this green color, that is in the line MN, whatever data we get, that is our H dash value. that is absolute enthalpy value corresponding to the chosen temperature. Okay, so what we get is, we will get a table. So we are evaluating the value to get what is 1 by h star minus h dash. Okay, so it is between, we have chosen a temperature of TL1 up to TL2 in between uniform interval. So whatever is the y-axis value corresponding to operating line is our h dash. Whatever is the value corresponding to equilibrium curve is h dash, h star value, h star dash. So we can plot, we can determine what is 1 by h star minus h dash, and we have to plot a graph between this in y-axis and this in x-axis. Okay, so between these two values, if you plot a graph curve, so that's what you have written. So plot a curve between 1 by h star minus h dash versus h. So what we get is, we'll get a graph like this. Okay, so what we have get is a graph of 1 by h star minus h, this thing. So how to find the number of transfer units? We have already seen this number of transfer units with respect to overall mass transfer coefficient is area under the curve. In the plot of area under the curve in the plot, guess it is dh dash by h star dash minus h dash h1 dash h2 dash, right? So this is our NTU, area under the curve. Between this we will get one. So between h1 dash and h2 dash in this curve, you have to get that one. So how to get, how many in the plot? If you have a graph like this between TL1 and TL2, we have to count the number of squares. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 15, 20. First count the total full squares, then 2 half squares you can count as 1, 25, 2, these 2 together 26, next 2 together 27. Like that you can count the number of squares, multiply by scale. Okay, whatever scale, for example, whatever scale you are choosing, you have to keep 1 centimeter unit, what is the unit in x-axis, multiplied by whatever is the 1 centimeter in y-axis, you have to mark. For example, we may plot 0.001, here we may plot 0.002. So in that case, this is x in x-axis, 1 centimeter equal to 0.001, so that we have to write here. In y-axis it is 1.002. So whatever is the scale you are choosing, because whoever plotting the graph, if I have a paper, I can make a graph totally, all the graph plotted within this range. Ideally how to plot this graph, you have to plot like this fully. Okay, so you have to choose a scale accordingly. Okay, for example, my data range is 0 to 0.5. if I take 0.5 as one scale, my total graph will come here. Rather, you should take 0 to 0.5, means up to here we have to take full scale. So that and all will come with experience, because we will do the graphical problems in CRE, mass transfer, already we did in other courses also. Okay, so then what about height of transfer units? That is gs dash by kya. So if you know these values of kya will be given, gs dash you will get by doing material balance. Okay, so once we have this gs dash actual, gs dash actually is calculated, we calculated, right? So because gs dash minimum is calculated from the graph. Okay, once we mark this point M, up to tangent line is our gs dash minimum, and gs dash actual is equal to, say for example, 1.5 times gs dash minimum. So like that we will get the gs dash value. So we can substitute that to get the height of transfer units, and finally the height of the packed bed of a cooling tower is equal to number of transfer units into height of transfer units. Number of transfer units is area under the curve, which we will get here. Height of transfer units we will calculate, substitute both NTU and HTU value, finally we will get Z, height of the packed bed in terms of meters. Okay, so in this how to show that, so you can see that, so between these H values, this is our H dash values, so we have between H1 dash and H2 dash, and 1 by h star dash minus h dash, you can count the squares 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 13, then it is 14 is full, 15, 16, 17, together you can count 19 to 18, 19, like that. So 19, if I roughly we are saying, but to be specific you have to count in small box. Say for example one big box, there is 1 centimeter into 1 centimeter will have 100 squares, right? So that means if you add like 100, for full you can add hundreds. How many full circles are there, how many full squares? Up to 14 it is full square. 14 into 100, like that you can put a small scale. Okay, then even small boxes, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that, if you calculate you can get the values even more specific. But roughly I can say there are 19 squares. Okay, I consider there are 19 squares, so accordingly I write the scale. If you consider small boxes, you can write the scale accordingly. How much is each box? Okay, so 19 into, here you can see that each, what is the scale in x-axis? It is 100, it is 120, that is 20 is the scale. Okay, so 1 centimeter in x-axis into is equal to 20. Similarly, 1 centimeter in y-axis is, you can see 0.01, 0.02, that is 0.02 minus 0.01, it is 0.01. So that way area under the curve can be calculated. Okay, so now we will go for a numerical. Okay, let's solve a numerical on cooling towers problem. Okay, so I have told you already, either we can solve this problem using individual mass transfer coefficient method or overall mass transfer coefficient method. Okay, so for overall mass transfer coefficient, first thing we have to do is we have to determine the H value, that is humidity value, enthalpy value from the humidity chart for a given gas temperature and dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature of the entering air. Okay, so either two data is required, either dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature will be given so that we can get the absolute humidity. Okay, or we can get, it may be given that dry bulb temperature and percentage relative humidity are given so that you can determine the absolute humidity. Okay, so then we can determine the enthalpy value using the formula. Okay, we can plot the equilibrium curve. If H versus L data is given, that here H dash HY refers to enthalpy. Okay, so enthalpy versus liquid temperature is given, means we can plot the equilibrium curve. So we will have equilibrium plot versus enthalpy versus liquid temperature. So this is our equilibrium line. Okay, we will have a equilibrium line like this. Okay, so then we will mark the operating line equation, which will have a slope of L into Cp of water by Gs dash. Okay, so this is the operating line equation for cooling operation in a packed bed. Okay, then so we will be drawing a slanting line if it is individual mass transfer coefficient, or we will draw a vertical line if it is for overall mass transfer coefficient. Okay, so take down this problem. Hot water at 45 degrees Celsius is to be cooled in an induced draft cooling tower which is in contact with the air to a temperature of 29 degrees Celsius. That means from 45 degrees Celsius, hot water needs to be cooled from 45 degrees Celsius to 29 degrees Celsius. Calculate the minimum air required in kg per second. So we have to determine the Gs dash. What is the minimum amount of gas required? Second part is, calculate the minimum height of the packed tower required in meters if the actual flow rate is taken as 1.4 times the minimum gas flow rate in kg per second. Kya bar is given as 0.9 kg per meter cube second, where the driving force is in delta y dash. The entering air has a dry bulb temperature of 30 degrees Celsius and a wet bulb temperature of 23 degrees Celsius. So that is the data of the entering gas is given, and water flow rate is given as 15 kg per second. Cp of water is known, 4.186, or you can say 4.19 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Latent heat of vaporization of water is given as 2502 kilojoule per kg at 1 atmosphere. And saturation enthalpy versus temperature data is given. So we have temperature of the liquid in degree Celsius from 29 to 45, and saturation enthalpy, H star value, this is for equilibrium curve plot. Okay, so kilojoule per kg dry air is given from 100 to 216 kilojoule per kg dry air. Okay, so these are the data given. So first, let us, you can write the data given, neatly write all the data given for liquid. First make a block diagram for counter current cooling tower. We have gas, so bottom condition refers to 1, top conditions refers to 2. So we can write liquid is entering here, liquid is leaving here. So gas is entering here, that is air is entering here, and air is leaving here. Okay, so GS dash value is what? And GS dash minimum first we have to determine, and then given, it is given that actual GS dash is 1.4 times GS minimum. Okay, and liquid L dash value is given. Okay, liquid flow rate is given, and temperature of the liquid entering is, it is, when we say TL1, this is TL2, right? So TL1, TL2, air is entering, that means temperature of the gas entering, what is the temperature? So all the data, if it is given, please write down. Then Cp of water is given, which is Cp of liquid. Cp of air is given, which is a CFS. Okay, see, air temperature is given, right? Air is entering, air temperature, dry bulb temperature is given, and wet bulb temperature is also given. So what is the air dry bulb temperature? Dry bulb temperature is, you don't confuse the water temperature. Water temperature is 45 and 29, both are temperature of waters. Okay, but here air entering here as a dry bulb temperature of 30 degree Celsius and wet bulb temperature of 23 degree Celsius. So what we can do in a psychrometric chart, you will have dry bulb temperature, you know wet bulb temperature will be here. So wet bulb temperature, whatever is the temperature, say for example it is 30 degree Celsius, wet bulb temperature is 23 degree Celsius. So here, so 20, between 20 and 25, 21, 22, 23. So in 23, you'll draw a line, mark the point, corresponding value will give you your y1 dash value, right? So this entering air will have an absolute humidity of y1 dash. Leaving air will have absolute humidity of y2 dash. So y1 dash is your absolute humidity. Humidity of entering air is y1 dash. So this will be obtained by from psychrometric chart. Okay, so that if you get that one, we will get the y1 dash value. So if you have y1 dash value, we have formula for CS. What is the formula for CS? CS equal to 1.005 plus 1.84 into y dash. Okay, therefore CS1 equal to 1.005 plus 1.84 into y1 dash. Okay, so y1 dash is entering air absolute humidity. Okay, so if you take a psychrometric chart, first what we have to do, dry bulb temperature, air inlet temperature is dry bulb temperature, that is given as 30 degree Celsius. So here you can see it is 30 degree Celsius. So you draw a line for 30 degree line, and then web dot temperature is given. So here in this, along this line, see, along this line we have, so along this line we have web dot temperature. It is given as 23 degrees Celsius. So this is 20 and this is 25. So we have 21, 22, 23. So this line, along this line, we will draw a line here. So we mark a point there. So if you mark a point there and draw a line in this, along this y axis, we get what is the, we get what is absolute humidity. So absolute humidity in this particular graph, it is not 20. It is written in this side, 0.015. So around that you will get, right? So we get absolute humidity value of 0.015. okay, so that we can note down. From the graph we get what is absolute humidity. Okay, so we get a value of around 0.015. okay, I repeat. So from the wet bulb temperature and dry bulb temperature, we mark them in the psychrometric chart, and the y-axis value gives us the absolute humidity. So for the given value of 30 degree Celsius dry bulb temperature and 23 degree Celsius of wet bulb temperature, from y-axis we get 0.015 to 016. Whatever you observe, you can write that. Okay, 0.015 is the value of absolute humidity. So we can determine the CS value, that is CP value of air. Moisture is 1.005 plus 1.84 into 0.015. okay, so once you substitute that value, please make use of your calculator to find what is the CS value. So you can calculate this 1.005 plus 1.84 into 0.015. so we get around 1.033 or 004 we will get. Okay, so CS value we get, which we can substitute here. Okay, so CS value is 1.003. so enthalpy value can be determined. Okay, so the enthalpy value is, formula we have CS into TG minus T naught plus lambda naught into Y1 dash. Y1 dash we have from graph 0.015, right? 0.015 is what we get from the chart with dry bulb temperature and given temperature. Temperature of the gas, entering gas, is given 30 degrees Celsius. T naught is reference temperature. So again, in this formula, Y1 dash is same, 0.015. okay, so this part also can be done. Enthalpy from first value, whatever we determine, we substitute that CS value here. So that way we have 1.033, and lambda naught value is, in the problem it is given. Actually, if you refer to any other sources, you will be getting around 2251 like that. Okay, 2350 like that we will get, 2257, something like that we will get. But in this master answer problem, we are using 2500 as the average value for this latent heat of evaporation. But anyhow, if you use this, that's also correct only. Okay, but for comparison of the answers and for evaluation, we will make use of this value if not specified as this. Okay, so if I substitute 2502, lambda naught value is known, CS value is known, TG value is, only we have to substitute. Okay, TG value is 30 minus 0 plus 2502 into, in this problem again, Y1 dash is 0.015. okay, so if we substitute the values using the calculator, we will get the answer 1.033 into 30 plus 2502 into 0.015. so what do you get? You write your answer, whatever you get. Okay, so you will get around 68 to 71. Whatever you get, it's okay, because here I corrected to 3 digit, so you can correct accordingly. Because whatever value, your own value, you may be, it is because something, it is more than 0.015. okay, so you can say 0.11 0.0155 like that, or 51 like that. Okay, so when you use that, obviously you will get the value in the range of 68 to 71. So unit is kilojoule per kg Kelvin. So H1 value we have, right? So we have H1 dash and TL1. Now we have temperature of the liquid at bottom condition and H1 dash also we know. So if we know this, this is point M, right? So we can mark that here. So from the given data, first thing to do is, the equilibrium data is given, right? Enthalpy curve we can plot, right? H star versus temperature of the liquid we can plot. Okay, so you will get a equilibrium curve. So from whatever is the data given, you plot the graph, that is first step. Second step is mark the point M. Mark the point M, where M is your TL1, that is liquid leaving temperature. Liquid is leaving at 29 degrees Celsius, if I am right. Okay, from 45 to 29 it is cooled, right? So that way your water at the bottom of the tower, it is leaving liquid is 29 degree, entering liquid is 45 degree Celsius. So that's why we have TL1 equal to 29 degree Celsius, and H1 dash we have just calculated. So whatever is the value, let me say 71 or 68. Okay, so you will plot this point M. Okay, so what we have to do is, if we have plot the equilibrium curve, you will get a line here. So this here is the point 28. So this is 31. It depends upon the scale you take. Okay, so for example, here in x-axis, I'll write the scale. In x-axis, one unit is equal to 3 degrees Celsius. In y-axis, one unit is equal to how much? 60, 80, that means 20. 20 kilojoule per kg. Okay, so you can easily say that if this is 28 and this is 31, this is 29.5, so slightly less than that, you can mark a point 29. Okay, so that way you can mark the point M here. Okay, so if you mark the point M with TL1 and H1 dash values. Okay, H1 dash values around 68 or 71 or whatever. Okay, so around here you will get. So that way you can mark the point. Okay, so once you mark the point M, that is with TL1 value of 68 or 71, or H1 dash value calculated is 71, or TL1 is fixed, right? That is 29 degrees Celsius, or this is 68 to 71. Whatever is the kilojoule per kg. Okay, now how to find the minimum airflow ratio? We know that from the material balance equation, we know the if the slope is maximum, we are going to have gas flow rate minimum. When we will have a maximum slope, that is possible up to this line, operating line, having a tangential line to the equilibrium line. So this is our equilibrium line. So if you draw a tangent line, so we will come to know what is the slope of this tangential line. From that we will get GS minimums, right? So this slope will give us, we have L into Cp of water by GS minimum, you can write in our usual term. Okay, so this is the slope of the one tangential line. Okay, so from the graph we will get what is dy by dx, slope of the tangential line. Okay, so if you draw the tangential line, you will get the slope. Okay, so first we can do that part. So if you, this is our plot M, you mark the point M. So once you mark the point M, this is our equilibrium curve. So that is your tangential line. So if you draw a tangential line to the equilibrium curve, so we can mark anything. How to mark the dy by dx? Take any value dy and some value dx, right? So if it is that, so if you take dy by dx value, that is your slope. Okay, so once you get the slope value, we can proceed further. So in this, if you consider a big one, I'm just drawing it for understanding purpose. You can make a very small value also. Okay, so if I draw a rectangle for this finding the slope, so this is my dy. Okay, so what we have here is dy and this is our dx value. So dy by dx value can be obtained by finding out what is the value here and here, right? So if I draw that line, so my dy value is like 180 minus 102 or 106. Okay, similarly my dx values are, you can see that it is around here, it is 43, slightly less than 43, I can say 42. Here it is slightly less than 34, so you can say 33. So 42 minus 33, like that we can find out, you get the exact value. So I just write a randomly whatever I got. We are writing as 8.2. so you can write what is your actual slope value, how to determine considering a small increment in the slope dy and dx. You find the values from the scale, subtract it to get what is the slope. Once we have the slope value, we can recall our lecture number 39. In our lecture number 39, at the time of 30th minute, we have derived the expression where we have equation number 2. Equation number 2 is our enthalpy balance across the thickness dz. So we have that dh dash by dtl equal to l dash cl by gs dash, right? So this is applicable. I told you this is the slope. Dh by dl is nothing but slope. The slope will be maximum when gs dash is minimum. So that condition we are going to use. So now, just now we have seen how to get the slope value. So if you plot the graph, you can find out the slope value to be 8. Okay, so we just found the slope value is equal to 8. Okay, so now slope is equal to whatever is the value you got, say for example 8. Okay, then this is equal to ls dash cl by gs minimum. So now in this, gs minimum is the only unknown parameter. Remaining parameters we know, because liquid flow rate is given like 15 kg per second, cp of water is given like what is the value, 4.19. okay, so with this all the parameters are known, you can say gs minimum is equal to gs dash cl by slope. So slope value is, this is 8 from graph. Okay, so ls dash value is 15, cp value, cl value is 4.19 divided by slope value. So please use your calculator. So 15 into 4.19 divided by 8. So we will get around 7.856. Okay, 7.856, that's whatever value you are getting, you can write. Okay, 3 digits you can write, 7.5. please report your GS minimum value. Okay, so that is your kilojoules per second we get. Okay, so GS dash value is given, and the second part, first part answer is got obtained. This is the answer for first part. Second part question is, if it is GS dash actual, GS actual gas flow, actual gas flow rate is given as 1.4 times minimum GS obtained from section A, that is section 1. So we can calculate what is our GS dash actual. 1.4 into 7.8, which will be around equal to 10.8 to 11. Okay, so you'll get around 10.8 to 11. Please comment your answer. So you'll take it to be 11. Okay, just for showing you the calculation, I am using 11, but we use whatever you are getting, GS dash actual. Okay, so once we have GS dash actual, so we just got GS dash actual equal to around 11. Okay, so now, okay, if you refer to our lecture number 39, around 31st minute, we have written the enthalpy balance across the thickness dz, where equation number 2 in lecture number 39, we have dh dash by dtl equal to l dash cl by gs dash. So this is our operating line equation's slope. So the slope of the operating line will be equal to l dash cl by gs dash. So when the slope will be maximum, when the slope is maximum, we are going to have gs dash minimum. Okay, so if gs dash is minimum, your slope will dh by dtl will be maximum. Okay, similarly we can write the actual case. For actual case, usually gs dash actual will be 1.3 to 1.5 times gs dash minimum. So accordingly you can write gs dash actual, so dh dash by dtl actual is equal to l dash cl by gs dash actual. Okay, so this we will make use here. Same can be written, dh dash by dtl actual is equal to l dash cl by gs actual. So if it is actual, this is going to be actual, right? So this is nothing but h2 dash minus h1 dash, h2 actual, right? So h2 actual divided by tl2 minus tl1, right? So that we can do now. Okay, so from this we can write okay, now again we can say that h2 minus h1, h2 dash minus h1 dash by tl2 minus tl1, that is the slope, right? Dh by dl, sorry, dh by dt is equal to, again we have the dls dash cl by gs dash actual. Okay, so now we have water vapor value. Is what is the value for water? It is 15 into Cp of water is 4.186 or 4.19 given us in this problem. Gs dash actually is around 11 kg per second. Okay, you can check the all the things, kg per second, this is kilojoules per kg, so all the kg getting cancelled. Second getting cancelled, so you get kilojoules per kg. Kelvin will be there, right? Kilojoules Kelvin. Okay, now what is the value? Please use your calculator. 15 into 4.19 divided by 11, so we will get around 160 plus 15 into 4.19 divided by 11, 5.71. Okay, so we have h2 dash minus, we have already calculated what is h1 dash value. What is h1 dash value? H1 dash value we calculated around 71, 68 to 71 I told you. So whatever we get, you write. Okay, 71 h1 dash value, we get around 68 to 71 I told you. You write, comment your h1 dash value, correct value. So h2 dash minus h1 dash by tl2 minus tl1, that is 45 degree it is entering and 29 degree it is leaving. Okay, so now if clear you can get the h2 dash value to be this much kilojoules per kg of dry air. Okay, so what is h2 dash value? Simplifying, this is 16, 30, 15 plus 1, 16. 16 into 5.71 plus 71.05 gives us around 162.46 is the h2 dash value. Okay, so now we can mark the point N, right? Mark the point N, where N is your TL2 comma h2 dash. That is TL2 value is, that is liquid is entering at 45 degrees Celsius, comma H2 dash value is around 162.46 kilojoules per kg dry air. Okay, so can we mark this point in the same equilibrium curve? So in this equilibrium curve, so the temperature of the liquid TL2 is around 45 degrees Celsius and your value is around 160, this is 170. For 162 you can mark somewhere here, right? So you can, we have already marked the point M. Now you can mark the point N, where N equal to x axis is 45 degrees Celsius, y axis is 162 kilojoule per kg, and join M, N. Joining M and what we get is join M and, so that is our operating line equation. Operating line equation for cooling tower. Okay. Now, between these temperature TL1 and TL2, what we have to do is, we have to choose this TL1, TL2. Already we have marked here, right? TL1 is here, TL2 is here. Okay. So, TL1, between TL1, that is 29 degrees Celsius and 45 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now, we have to choose that in equal intervals, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that you can choose any, it's up to you. Only thing is, between these two range, at least minimum 5 data, depending upon the time available, we should minimum to have a graph, at least have 5 set of values. So what you can do is, take a value. How to take the value is, draw the lines. Okay. So if you draw a vertical lines from these temperatures between TL1 and TL2, and we have told you that it is equilibrium curve is H star value, operating line is H dash value. Okay, so this is your enthalpy, this is your saturation enthalpy. So any line, if you take the corresponding value in x y axis, so this along this up, this one will give us our H dash value, and if you go here, it will give us our H star value. So each set of value for each temperature, that's what we have explained to you already also. For temperature, what is the corresponding H star value? H star value you will get from this curve. This curve is H star value, this is H dash value. So in this curve, we will get H star values. So in this equilibrium curve, whatever is the corresponding value in the Y axis, we have already explained to you. So the corresponding value first will give us the H star values. Please fill those H star values in their table. Make a table and fill the value. And similarly, H dash value is green color, I have explained you already. So in the, all the corresponding values will give us the H dash values. So we can again fill those H dash values in the table. Now we know H star value, we know H dash value. So you can determine what is 1 by H star minus H dash value also. Okay, so for the, you can evaluate these values. So please get the values of 1 by H star, because we have H star value, we have H dash value. H star value we get from equilibrium curve, H dash value we get from operating line. You take all the, some 5 to 6 values, take your time. And if you if we have chosen some temperatures, so whatever is y axis value from the operating line, it is H dash value. Whatever is the y axis value from the equilibrium line, that is our H star value. And we evaluate 1 by H star minus H dash values, and we will plot this H dash versus, we will plot this H dash versus H dash in X axis. We will take H dash in X axis and 1 by H star minus H dash in Y axis. Okay, so that is H dash versus 1 by H star minus H dash value. We will get the equilibrium curve. Okay, so whatever may be the shape, we will get a equilibrium curve. Sorry, we will get the plot between this. Why we are doing this? Because area under this curve between H1 dash and H2 dash is our number of transfer units. So for that we are taking values. So at each temperature, whatever is the y axis value if in the operating line and y axis value in the equilibrium line, you can get the values like this. Okay, so you do your own calculation. For example, I got 29, 33, 37, 41, 45 degrees Celsius lines. The corresponding lines in the operating line, in the operating line, corresponding y axis values are 72, 96, 116, 134, 162. Similarly, from the equilibrium line, the corresponding y axis values are 100, 118, 142, 170, 218. So h star minus h dash inverse of it, values are written here. Okay, so now we can plot 1 by h star minus h dash minus h star versus h dash value. Okay, so if you plot the curve, you will get like this, 1 by h star minus h dash versus h dash value. I have already explained you how to find the area under the curve. So here you can see how many number of squares are there. You can almost roughly around 19 squares are there. So 19 into, so we have to write the scale in x-axis. Here the scale in x-axis is 20 degrees Celsius. Okay. And 20 degrees Celsius in x-axis, 0.01. You just subtract two values. Okay. 160 minus 140 is 20. So that is my scale in x-axis. It's better to write the scale for x-axis and y-axis. In x-axis, 1 unit is equal to 20 degrees Celsius, and unit is equal to 0.02 minus 0.01 is 0.01. Okay, so that way, while finally after finding the number of squares, I'll do it here. Okay, number of squares is 19 into, in x-axis 1 centimeter is equal to 20 degrees Celsius, in y-axis 1 centimeter is equal to 0.01. So if you multiply that, we will get the NTU value. Okay, so what is the value for NTU? So what is the value of NTU? NTU is equal to area under the curve in the plot of h dash versus 1 by h star minus h dash between the limits h1 dash and h2 dash. Okay, so if you plot that, we had area under the curve is equal to 19 into 20 into 0.01, which is equal to 3.8. so you will get around 3.5 to 4. Okay, so whatever is your answer, please comment your answer. Okay, that is our NTU, and we know that actually HTU determination is simple step. We have done in absorption also. HTU is given GS by KYA, right? GS value already there. What is that? We have calculated it around 10.8 to 11.5, whatever you get. So 11 is around value, 11 kg per second is our GS dash actual, divided by KY into A value is directly given as 0.9. Okay, so that value is given. Okay, so 11 by 0.9 is around 12.22. that is your HTU value, and this is your NTU value. Then what is height of the packed tower? Height of the packed tower, Z is equal to NTU into HTU, that is 3.8 into 12.22. So what is the value? Okay, so that is the meters. This is the height of the packed bed. Okay, so you have to comment your final answer. So comment your NTU value and Z values. Okay. So same way, you can solve any number of problems. Please solve these practice problems which are given at the end of this lecture. Okay. So for general procedure, I have already explained. So solve this problem where a forced draft counter current water cooling tower is to cool water from 43.3 to 26.7. The air is entering the bottom of the tower at 23.9. with a wet bulb temperature of 21.1. The value of Sg for the conditions is 0.533 meter. okay, height of transfer unit is directly given. Final step, NTU into HTU, you will substitute in HTU value as 0.533. the heat transfer resistance in the liquid phase will be neglected since HL is very large, hence values of Hy dash should be used. Calculate the tower height needed if 1.5 times the minimum air flow rate is used. Okay, so that is one problem. Well, so in this lecture, we have seen what is the standard procedure to determine the height of a packed bed using psychrometric chart and enthalpy saturation curve and the operating line equations. And we have solved a few numericals also. So practice more numericals like this. Thank you so much for joining my classroom. Meet you in the next lecture. Bye-bye.